You may be seated. Join me in prayer, please. Dear Heavenly Father, we're thankful for the opportunity to come to your house this morning. And God, as we assemble together to worship your name, I pray that every song we sing, every word that is preached, every thought is thought, would bring honor to you. For truly, you are the only one worthy of all honor and praise this morning. God, I thank you for each one that is assembled here together this morning. I just pray that you'd help us to listen and reflect and be obedient to whatever it is you want us to do this day. And we ask all this in the mighty name of Jesus, our Lord and our Savior. Amen. Well, let me officially welcome you to Pleasant Hill this morning. And if you're a guest of ours this morning, I want to encourage you to take your bulletin and tear out that perforated section and do us the honor of giving us a little information so we can know you're here with us today. And if you have any ministry needs this week that we can help serve you in, I pray that you would give us that opportunity to do so. Again, we're very thankful you're here. And for all of you that is here this morning, would you stand and take just a moment and greet those right around you.
You may be seated. We always hate to interrupt good fellowship time, but we want to continue our time of worship this morning. You know, several weeks ago, we assembled at a undisclosed location, and that's where we do our planning, where we're not interrupted, where we don't have phone calls. We even put our cell phones up. We check them about every 2 hours to make sure there are no emergencies, but we want to concentrate on what the Lord wants us to do as a ministerial and support staff. And one of the things that we came up with was a series of sermons based on why we love our church. And it was kind of unusual to sit around a table and just let everybody join in on reasons why we love our church. And basically, our staff planned that series of sermons that we have been going through the last few weeks. Then we came to a time where we thought, well, we need to involve lay people and other ministers. And we got to today's message. I love my church because I get to share Jesus. We didn't hesitate to the person that we wanted to share his testimony. I have been in the ministry for over 35 years, and I have never been with someone who shares their faith as lovingly and passionately as David Honeycutt. I have said he will witness to a telephone pole if given a chance. I've been on an airplane with him, and he's been three rows behind me. And before we exit that plane, he has shared his faith with the person seated next to him. I call him my Timothy. I call him my son in the ministry, and I appreciate his being a part of our ministerial staff. One of the best things this church has ever done is call him as Minister of Youth and Missions. So I've asked Dave to come if he'll share with us this morning.
Well, it's truly an honor to serve at Pleasant Hill and an honor to share with you a testimony of why I love my church. And today I can say one of the many reasons that I love my church is I love my church because it helps me to share the gospel. It started a long, long time ago. I love my church because this is the place where I heard the gospel for the very first time. I grew up in the Pleasant Hill community. Some of you may not know that, but I grew up in the Pleasant Hill community and in this church, and the Lord called me away from this church for a few years to go pastor a church over in the edge of Alabama, and then the Lord saw fit to call me back home as youth and missions pastor, but I love my church because if it wouldn't have been for Pleasant Hill Baptist Church, I may have never heard the gospel. I love my church because of the people that give of themselves to invest in the lives of others for the purpose of sharing the gospel. Some of my fondest memories as a child are my parents bringing me to Pleasant Hill Baptist Church as a child, making friends and hearing God's word told through Bible stories and teaching me about God's love. I can remember walking to church with my grandfather many years ago on a pretty sunny day, kind of like today, walking with my grandfather down Lacey Road to come to church and come to Sunday school and worship and hear about God's love. I can remember my family bringing me to church at a very early age. I can remember my brother and I riding our bicycles to Vacation Bible School in the summertime to hear God's love proclaimed and hear the word of God taught through Bible stories and sharing the gospel. One thing I remember in particular, my mom was the Vacation Bible School director 1 year, and then they would rotate, and Miss Maxine Junkin would be the Vacation Bible School director. They would rotate their responsibilities. And I can remember one day specifically when Miss Maxine Junkin was sharing the missionary emphasis that day, and she was sharing about how people gave their lives to share Christ. And I can remember the Lord tugging at my heart that very day when she told that story about the missionary and how the missionaries would go to the lost and share the gospel with them all over the world. I love my church because people like Gene Stallings that were so faithful to teach children's church to a bunch of energetic children during worship. I love my church because of people like Linda Williams that taught Sunday school to me as a young child and is still teaching children today. I love my church because of people like Philip Logan that taught me as a junior high boy, of people like Jalois Weeks that taught me as a high school boy and as a teenager. I could go on and on about people in this church that invested not only in my life, but in the lives of so many other children and teenagers and teaching them to share the gospel. These people and many others have given themselves to the Lord to invest in my life and many others. I love my church because it's full of people who give to the Lord. You give of your time, you give of your talents, you give of your life, and because of your life, and because of you giving of your life, I'm a life that has been changed. And now I have a passion for sharing the gospel with others. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1 through 3 says this, "You then, my child, be strengthened by the grace that is in Christ Jesus with what you have heard in the presence of many witnesses, entrust to the faithful who will be able to teach others also." The Apostle Paul experienced the love of Christ. He passed it on to Timothy, and Timothy passed it on to others. And I love my church most of all because the gospel continues. It continues to be shared. We're all links in a chain that lead all the way back to the disciples who followed Christ. We all have opportunities to add links to that chain that will lead others to believe in Jesus Christ and trust them as the Lord and Savior. I love my church because our pastor keeps the gospel central. I love my church.
want to give you something today. And everybody gets one. Don't say, I don't like that. Be grateful. A gift is either elevated or degraded by how it is received. So everybody gets one. Everybody gets something today. All right, there we go. You get a gift, and you get a gift, and you get one. You get one. You get one. You get one. We're getting close to everybody getting one. I hope I have enough. Okay, you get one. 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 There you go. Who doesn't have one yet? Okay, pass those down. We got enough. Okay, you don't have one? You want another? Okay, you got two. Give him one. You get one, you get one. You only get one. That's right. Y'all are kind of greedy. All right. Does everybody have one? Who doesn't have one? Okay. All right. There you go. All right. Does everybody have one now? Okay. If you don't, all right. Everybody's got one. Okay. That put that back in there. All right. You have a piece of candy. Now, you have a choice. You can do one of two things with that piece of candy. You can keep it, or you can go give it to somebody else. But the choice is yours, okay? And if you're going to give it to somebody, I want you to do it in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go now. But if you want to keep it, you stay here, okay? No throwing. Okay? He wants to keep his. That's it. He can keep it. Okay, come on back. Okay. All right. Now, how many of you gave yours away? Okay, here you go. Here's you one. Here's you one. Here's you one. Who doesn't have one? Okay. Here, okay, you got one. You don't have one? You gave yours away? Okay. You got one? Okay, pass it on down. All right, you gave yours away. Does everybody have one now? Everybody's got one. Okay, listen closely. Okay, you don't? You gave yours away? All right, you gave yours away. Okay, you got one. Okay. Okay, you don't got one. Okay. Love that good English. Okay. When we accept Jesus, and Jesus is our Lord and Savior, we can do one of two things. Gotta put that down, sweetie. Okay. We can do one of two things. We can either try to keep it, or we can give it away. Now, he's told us that we are to give his love to others. And you know what a strange thing happens when we give the love of God to others? It comes back to us. It comes back to us. You gave your candy away, but you got another piece of candy, didn't you? That's kind of the way it is with the love of God. And you'll learn, sometimes we want to hold on to it. And I get that. There are things I want to hold on to as well. But trust God that when you give his love to others, it's always going to come back to you. Okay? All right. Let's pray. Father, we thank you today for your grace and for your mercy and for the opportunity that is ours to share your love with others. Bless these children as they go their time of worship. In your son's name I pray. Let me encourage you this morning to take a copy of God's Word and open it to the Gospel of Matthew, 28th chapter. Begin reading verse 19 through verse 20, and also 2 Corinthians, the 5th chapter, verses 18 through 20. Again, we are without Franklin this week, not because he drove off in a ravine this week. You know, we're writing the book of Franklin. Franklin was here last night and was doing his work, and about 1 o'clock this morning got a call from Meridian that his wife needed to be taken to the emergency room. She was extremely sick, so he drove back to Meridian. They have admitted her into the hospital, and he has taken care of her. So people just step up, and we always say that individuals are not irreplaceable. That's what we found out a few weeks ago when I was sick and text David at 6 in the morning and told him he had it. And then God used him. And I'm thankful for this choir. I'm thankful for their time and their efforts and their talents of leading us to the throne of grace through the ministry of music. Let's stand as we honor the reading of God's Word this morning. Matthew 28, verse 19 through 20. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, even unto the end of the ages. What do we know that as? The Great Commission. Okay, let's look in 2 Corinthians, the 5th chapter. Verses 18 through 20. Paul, writing to the church at Corinth, said, "All this from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting people's sins against them. And he has committed to us the message of reconciliation. We are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God." And this is the word of God for the people of God. And may God add his blessings to the reading of his holy, inspired word. And all God's people together said, amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Several years ago, I read a story, a parable, an allegory, if you will, that has stayed with me and is constantly on my mind when I think about the church. The story goes something like this. As a matter of fact, it goes exactly like this. There was a group of lifeguards that were responsible for patrolling a certain area of beach, much like the old show Baywatch. They had a little lifeguards tower. And whenever someone would get in trouble in the ocean, they would swim out, bring the person back to safety. Well, one day this man was swimming in the ocean and the current took him a little bit too far from shore. And in his distress, one of the lifeguards saw him go down not once, not twice, but he was going down for the last time. And with that, he sprang into action, ran out into the water without any regard to his own life, swam, grabbed the man, brought him back to shore. He wasn't breathing, so immediately they began to do CPR, and as he pumped on his chest, water was coming from his mouth, and about that time, there was a big gasp and a big cough, and this man's life was literally thrust back into it. He was a wealthy man, and he wanted to show his appreciation to these lifeguards who put their life at risk to help others. So what he did was, he said, I'm going to build you a state-of-the-art lifeguard center. It's going to be like nothing that you have ever seen before. And so construction began of that lifeguard stand, or lifeguard complex, if you will. It wasn't just a chair, but rather, it was almost like a little condominium that he built. I mean, you could go up the steps. It had a porch that went all the way around it, and on the inside of that facility, there was air conditioning. There were plasma TVs, there were coffee pots, there was a refrigerator. There were all of the modern conveniences of home right there in that lifeguard stand. Those lifeguards would come in out of the heat, and they would sit in beautiful leather lounge chairs, watch TV or listen to the music. And before too long, the lifeguards started spending more and more time inside rather than outside. And people could be out in the ocean, drowning, screaming for help, but they couldn't hear because they were on the inside and not the out. Now, folks, to me, that's a parable of the church. You know, we were called, commissioned to go and be the witnesses of God to this world. As a matter of fact, a few moments ago when we read that passage of Scripture, I asked you, what is this? And you quickly responded, it is the Great Commission. It was a commission that He gave to us. But this is what happens. Oftentimes, the church builds marvelous facilities, beautiful sanctuaries, if you will, where religious people such as you and me gather, and we enjoy sermons as long as they aren't too demanding and they kind of help our convenience. We forget about those outside the church that don't know Christ. And we become more like a religious club, if you will. Our scripture from Matthew is very direct. Jesus had gathered with His disciples on an unknown mountain following His resurrection. And He gave them the Great Commission, not the Great Option. It was the Great Commission. It was a missionary responsibility. And first of all, I want you to know that He starts off with a very great claim about His authority. He says this: all power in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Now, who can make such a claim like that? Some Galilean peasant, this carpenter from Nazareth, this traveling itinerant preacher? But these words echo throughout the New Testament about the authority of Jesus Christ. If you look in Philippians chapter 2, there's a beautiful hymn that Paul wrote. It goes something like this: Jesus, who being in the very nature of God, did not think equality with God was something to be grasped hold of, but He humbled Himself and took on the form of a servant and was obedient even unto death, death on the cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted Him and has given Him the name which is above every other name, that at the name of Jesus Christ, every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the Father. God has highly exalted Him and given Him the name which is above every other name. And the New Testament underscores that authority. All authority has been given unto Him. And down through the ages, regardless of what the current trend is in our society, down through the ages, and today and tomorrow and 10 years from now, Jesus Christ will still make a difference in people's lives. He makes the difference in the lives of kings. He makes the difference in the lives of emperors. He makes the difference in the life of presidents, CEOs. He makes the difference in the life of the poor and the life of the rich, of the educated and the uneducated. He is the difference maker, because all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to him. He has the authority in our lives, and he has to have the authority in our church as well. In the life of the church and in the life of his disciples, of those who follow him. Jesus gave the church an announcement, if you will, of his commission. This is what he said. You go and make disciples. Now I want you to think about that sentence structure there. You go and make disciples. Do you know that literally means as you are going? He's making the assumption. He is making the assumption that you are sharing your faith. As you are going, he's not talking to the pastors. He's not talking to the ministers of music. He's not talking to just the Sunday school teachers. He is talking to everybody who has ever placed their faith and trust in Christ Jesus. He has given you this commission. As you are going, you are to baptize. You are to teach. You are to make disciples. This was never an option. Not one time was it an option. If you love your church, you will love Christ. If you love Christ, you will love his church. The two cannot be separated. I have individuals all the time say, well, I love God, I just don't love the church. Impossible. You can't do it. God is the head of the church. This is his church. We are his disciples. We are his people. We are the ones that he has commissioned to do his work. So he has given us a responsibility to share the gospel with others. And because you love Christ, because you love your church, you have an opportunity to share with them the greatest news that has ever been shared in all of history. Do you realize that? You get to share something of eternal consequence that matters eternally. So here is my question. Because statistics will tell us that in between 80 and 90% of all believers will never share their faith once. Never. If I were to ask you to hold your hands up today, which I'm not going to do, I'm not going to embarrass you. And if I were to ask you, have you ever once sat down with somebody and shared your faith with them? A lot of you are going to say, kind of failed in that area. So why aren't we? Listen. Scripture is clear. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes unto the Father but through me. How many of us believe that? Well, this morning. Well, let's do better. You believe that, stand up. We believe that he is the way, the truth, and the life. Stand up. Okay, if you're physically able. Okay, I'm just going to pan the room. That's 100%. Okay, you can be seated. Okay, now if he says, I am the way, the truth, and the life, no man comes unto the Father except through me, then you and I know that those who don't come to him through Christ, what happens? They don't have a chance. A person outside the grace and the love of God, the moment they die, they're going to split hell wide open. So if you believe that, my question is, why aren't you sharing it? Well, I know what you're going to say. I don't know any non-Christians. Let me tell you something. There are non-Christians in this room today. Billy Graham once said that the greatest evangelism field in the world is the local church. Now, there are folks here that are religious, but so was the Ayatollah Khomeini. So was bin Laden. Religious. He wants to know if you're really following him. So we just kind of assume that everybody that we see is a Christian. Or we have bought into a devil's lie that everybody's going to heaven. Well, if everybody was going to heaven, why did Christ have to die for sin? We're too timid. We are too timid. Oh, we're too shy. I can never talk about such spiritual things. Why not? Talk about everything else. You can talk about sports. Well, that's easy. Why? Because it's a passion of mine. Well, shouldn't Christ be a passion? You see, you're going to be able to reach people that I'm not going to be able to reach. You're going to be able to talk to people that I'm not going to be able to talk to. As a matter of fact, you will have a greater opportunity to win somebody to Christ than me. Because someone will look at me and say, oh, that's just your job. And it's really not just my job. That's your job. That is your job. Oh, we lack the training. I don't know what to say. Can I help you with that? Got your Bibles? Open up to John 3:16. That's all you need. That is all you need to witness to somebody and tell them about how God has provided for them a way to come to him through his one and only Son. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. It's the Bible in a nutshell. It's the greatest sentence ever written. The greatest words ever spoken. So if you've got that, you can, listen to me. You can mutter through a plan of salvation because the Holy Spirit will give you the words to say. I've seen it time and time again. But really a question that we ought to ask ourselves is, why should we be willing to share with others? The first, it's a command. What do you not get about a command? A command that's given to a soldier is either obeyed or disobeyed. If it is obeyed, there are no consequences, correct? If it disobeys that, there are going to be consequences. So likewise, if God gives you a command, that command is not obeyed, there are going to be consequences. Second, you share this out of concern for other people. Let me tell you something. I'm going to tell you something that I really don't like. And I think sometimes we get kind of caught up a little bit at ball games. I have never understood why you would tell anybody or any institution or any group of people to go to hell. And it's chanted every day at almost every college football game. If you really knew what hell was like, you wouldn't want anybody to go there. Let me remind you, this life, for the majority of you, is the only hell you're ever going to know. But the sad part is, for some of you here, this is the only heaven you're going to know. It's a command, and we share out of concern. If I had the cure for cancer today, and by the way, this is Breast Cancer Awareness Month. Wear pink. If you got it, wear pink, guys. And I love a guy that says, well, I don't wear pink. It's not masculine enough. Well, just think of it as light red. Okay? It's just light red is all it is. But sometimes, I've specifically picked this out for people that have been affected by breast cancer in our church. How many have been affected by that? That's one way or another. Yeah. This is to honor you. If I had a cure for cancer and I kept it to myself and never shared it, I would be the most callous and cold individual who ever breathed. But you have the cure for eternity through Christ. No one dies through him. You get that, don't you? So if you have that, it's beyond me why you wouldn't share it with others. Jesus said we are to baptize and make disciples. We baptize those who have committed their lives to Christ. Do you know what baptism is? Baptism does not mean that you're going to heaven. Baptism is an acted parable, if you will, of being dead to your old life, being raised to walk in the newness of life. I watched my dad baptize so many times. Do you know what I say in the baptistry is exactly what he says? And I found it interesting when I went to another church, my pastor there said the same thing. I said, doggone it. Where are they getting this? They're getting it from the Bible. Therefore, we're baptized. We are raised to walk in the newness of life. Jesus, when he was baptized, went up straightway out of the water. And so you and I baptize those to signify that they have died to their old life, raised to walk in the newness of life. In the early church, we see many disciples witnessing for Christ. They were preaching in the synagogues. They were talking on the street corners. They were telling everybody that came that they were witnesses of what they had held. They were witnesses of what they had seen. They were witnesses, if you will, of what God had done to them through Christ Jesus. The early disciples utilized their opportunities wherever they would go. They were enthusiastic about sharing the love of God. I mean, enthusiastic. You know how enthusiastic they were? They were accused of being drunk. These people, you got to look at them. They're just drunk. I can assure you, it's been a long time since I've seen somebody so fired up for Jesus, they look like they were drunk. Make disciples as you teach. It's not just baptizing them. We have to teach them what we know. We have to disciple them. Converts need to grow in their faith and not just stay where they are. You are to grow each and every day. What makes this position frustrating sometimes is I will have somebody that will come to me and we'll sit down and talk, and they'll tell me that they're going to leave the church. They become disillusioned. And they'll say something like this. And believe me, after 30-plus years of doing this, I don't take it personally. But you know what they'll say? Preacher, you know what? I just got to go somewhere where I can be fed. I'm just not getting fed here. I'm just not getting fed here. And I want to say, well, open up your mouth. Let us give you the bread of life. Sometimes you're not getting fed because you're not coming to the table. You're not hearing what you want to hear. You're not hearing the message that you have wanted to hear in your mind. You see, when I became a pastor, my goal was to grow disciples. To not preach what you want to hear, but to preach what you need to hear. I have people that ask me all the time, say, Well, where do you get your sermons? Who writes your sermons? I'll tell you who writes my sermons. Peter, James, and John, and Jesus, they all come from the same book. All come from the same book. And here's the deal. You cannot stay in the milk of the Word. You have to go deeper into the meat and the potatoes and grow in your faith. There are churches out there, and I'm not being judgmental, they are 1,000 miles wide, but they're about an inch deep. Because they don't want to tell you anything about the cross. They don't want to tell you anything about the atonement. They don't want to tell you about denying yourself. They don't want to tell you anything about taking up your cross. They don't want to talk to you about a life of surrender and a life of commitment. They want to tell you, if you just give your life to Jesus, everything's going to be okay. Folks, that's not the gospel. When I look at those 11 followers of Christ following the hanging of Judas, all of them martyred for their belief, with the exception of one. He got a one-way ticket to the island of Patmos, where he was put in seclusion. Jesus said, anybody wants to be my disciple, they must deny themselves, take up their cross, and follow me. It's not easy. This Christian thing is hard. But I'm thankful that I've had teachers, I've had preachers, I've had individuals who've challenged me to grow in my faith. Let me tell you, if you're not deeper in your faith now than where you were 2 years ago, there's something wrong with you. If you hadn't advanced in how you think about God, there's some non-negotiables. We've talked about those. But God is always evolving. God is always changing. We need to realize that when we baptize somebody, that is not the end, but that is the beginning. That is the beginning. Finally, Jesus gives us the assurance of his presence. He says this, I am always with you. I am always with you. Does that I am remind you of something? To remind you of the Old Testament meeting that Moses had with burning bush, when Moses said, who shall I say has sent me? God responded by saying what? Tell him I am. And Jesus here is saying, I am always with you. Listen to me. Think about it for a moment. God's always with us, even when we think he's silent. I mean, we can be thankful for a beautiful place that we have to worship. We can be thankful this morning that we have great, dedicated life group teachers that are sharing the word on a weekly basis. We can be thankful that God is doing great things in our midst here at this church. We have good staff, and God is adding to that staff almost each and every year. We need to remember our major mission after we worship is to share the good news of Christ with someone that doesn't know him. Do you know him? If you know him, are you willing to share him? I can't tell you how many times I've shared the gospel with somebody. And you know, it's kind of frustrating because not every time that I've shared the gospel has somebody replied with yes. Almost as many times as not, they've said no. But that's on them. I've just shared. My dad was a hospital chaplain his last few years of active ministry. He He'd retired from the local church, was a chaplain at Baptist Hospital. And again, I wish y'all could have known my parents. That's one of the things that disappoints me so much, is y'all didn't get to know them. You would have loved my dad. He would have already preached here for me. And he would have told you that when he was preaching that you were listening to the real hurt. He and I pastored in the same town together for 5 years. We pastored in Canton. I pastored First Baptist. He pastored at Calvary. And this is what he would always say. First Baptist got the cheap imitation. Calvary got the real deal. And so he was just an unusual guy, but he loved to share the gospel. And the reason he loved to share the gospel, he knew that was his job. He knew that was his job. That was what he was called to do. Always carried with him a Gideon's Bible. Always. And a lot of times he would wind up giving that Gideon Bible away to the person that maybe he led to the Lord. He's working at a hospital chaplain, and he gets a call that a patient has requested to see him. So he goes into the hospital room, and this guy is in the bed, and he tells my dad, you know, I'm just not sure. I'm just not sure. I don't think I know Christ. I don't know if I died today. I don't know what would happen to me. No, Dad pulls out that Gideon Bible and goes through the plan of salvation with him. And at the very end, he looked at him and said, do you know Christ as your Lord and Savior? He said, I do not. He said, is there any reason why you wouldn't want to accept Christ as your Savior and your Lord? He said, there is none. He said, would you pray the prayer? And right then and there in that hospital bed, that man prayed the prayer and received Christ as a Savior. Dad said, here, you keep this Bible. Daddy knew a lot of Gideon, so he could get them free. It wasn't like he would buy them or anything. He'd go get him another one. And so he went on his way, and about 2 hours later, his beeper, used to have beepers back then, his beeper went off, looks at it, code blue. You know what a code blue is? Code blue is somebody's dying. Tells him what room to go to. He's not even thinking about it. Makes his way, kind of running down the hallway. Runs into the same room where he had witnessed this man 2 hours earlier. This man died. You know how long he was a Christian? 2 hours. 2 hours. God is more concerned with direction headed than distance covered. There were two thieves, one on either side of Christ when he was crucified. One died and split hell wide open. The other one, Jesus said, today you will be with me in paradise. I wonder, when you die and go to heaven, which there's that assurance, I wonder if anybody will greet you there and say, thank you for getting me here. If you love your church, you'll share the love of God with the people you come in contact with each and every day. Pray that he will give you somebody and step back and watch. They'll come to you like a marching band. Father, we thank you today for the opportunity that is ours to understand the commission that you've given us, the authority of which you've given it. All power is given to you in heaven and on earth. And Father, I just pray today that we would realize that same power can radiate and penetrate through our lives and give us the strength and the wherewithal to share the good news. I pray, Heavenly Father, that as we leave this place today, we leave here knowing that you go before us, and that, Heavenly Father, you would desire for us to tell others what you've done for us. In your Son's name we pray. Amen. This morning we're going to sing a hymn of invitation, allow you to respond to what you've seen, what you've felt, and what you've heard. Maybe this morning you come giving your heart to Christ. Maybe you come rededicating your life or transferring a church membership. But there may be something else that you need to do today. Maybe there's somebody that you know. If they die today, they'd spend eternity outside the presence of God. Could be you. But if you know somebody, come and pray for that person. And pray that God would give you the opportunity to share the gospel with them. I can assure you, you ask him, he'll give you that opportunity. I've seen it too many times. Any decision you feel the Lord asking you to make, you do that as we stand and prayerfully sing together.